Hello and welcome again to this session of Drishti IAS. Today I am going to discuss with you the environment and ecology segment of UPSC prelims 2021. But before I begin the question one by one, I'll share my views as far as I think this year UPSC paper was somewhat on the easier side. And this I'm saying because the questions from geography, history, polity and economics, they were from the core topics. Okay, the topics which we normally study during our preparation. If you have prepared for 1 year seriously, then most of the questions from these segments you will be able to answer. Okay, and because of that, I feel that if you have scored around 50 effectively correct questions after deducting the negatives, then you should be seriously preparing for the mains exam. Okay, as far as the dynamic segments are concerned, like science and tech, environment ecology, the questions, some of the questions have surprised even us. In fact, in the environment ecology, the topic has moved to a large extent towards biology rather than the ecology. Okay, and even the current affairs which have been asked, they were also not expected. Okay, so as far as environment ecology is concerned, I'll rate the paper towards some of the questions have been not, you can say, of very high difficulty level, or you need some amount of luck to do those questions correct. One more trend which I observed in this year paper was that the intelligent guessing or the intelligent elimination, which usually helps us when we are, you can say, have some shortage of resource as far as knowledge is concerned. If we apply some tricks, if we apply some intelligent elimination, then we can come to the correct conclusion. But in this year paper, in almost all the questions, not just environment ecology, they have ensured that you cannot manage with those things. Okay. So let's start the discussion. Now, this is the question number one. R2 code of practices constitutes a tool available for promoting the adoption of what? Now, if you have read e-waste rules and then the within that there is a concept of extended producer responsibility EPR regimes, then you must have come across this R2 code of practices, which basically mean this responsible recycling standard. R2 means responsible recycling standard. It provides a common set of process, safety measures and documentation requirements for businesses that repair and recycle used electronics. So for the recycling of electronics, this code, which is known as responsible recycling code, is generally in use, and you could have come across this term if you have seriously prepared for the mains exam and read about the e-waste, read about the EPR, etc. Okay. Question number two, why is there a concern about copper smelting plants? Now, first of all, you should know why this question was asked. This question is in this paper because of the agitations around the Vedanta Sterlite plant in Tamil Nadu. In 2018, it was shut because of the agitation by the civil society environmental activists, and this was a copper smelting plant. Then the matter went to the NGT, and NGT later on allowed the opening of this plant. Then they went in to the Chennai High Court, and then the High Court said that no, this could not be allowed to open because of the concerns. The matter further went to Supreme Court, and there also there was no respite to Vedanta. It was not allowed to be opened. But during the oxygen crisis, during the COVID second wave, the Tamil Nadu government allowed the opening of this plant for the manufacture of oxygen. And because of all these controversies and news, it was, you can say, it was quite in news. UPSC has asked a question. Now, as far as those news are concerned, these two points. The copper slag can cause the leaching of some heavy metals into environment, and they may release sulfur dioxide as a pollutant. It was there. As far as this, they may release lethal quantities of carbon monoxide into the environment is concerned. This term lethal quantity of carbon monoxide is giving me a hint that I should go with 2 and 3. Because the copper smelting may not be giving you lethal quantities of carbon monoxide. As far as the slag containing the heavy metals are concerned, leaching process is concerned, this is to some extent true. In fact, it is one of the major concerns. And since these copper ores, copper pyrites, it is a sulfide ore, so sulfur dioxide will definitely be there as a pollutant. So I'll go with this. Okay. In the question number 1, R2 code of practices, this A option will be the correct option. Now, with reference to furnace oil, consider the following statements. Now, what is furnace oil? If you have the basic understanding of the fractional distillation process, now in this fractional distillation process, the crude is fed. And on the basis of boiling point, the several constituents are separated. Now, whatever is left is as a residue, the thick viscous liquid, that is furnace oil. It is used in some industries like power plants, some other industries as well, by mixing with some other fuel. So, it is a product of oil refinery. This is true. Even this, there was some news about furnace oil also. Probably because of that they have asked the question. Then some industries use it to generate power. This is also true. Yes, its use causes sulfur emissions into environment. Okay. In fact, sulfur is an important constituent of the crude oil. So this is always there, even in the case of diesel, petrol also. So it is also there in the furnace oil. So as far as this question is concerned, the correct option will be 1, 2 and 3. Okay, I'll be very quick because I know most of you will be interested in knowing the answer rather than the long discussion. That is the that is usually done in the normal classes. So what is blue carbon? Now this is straight away from the discussion. We have discussed blue carbon, black carbon, brown carbon, etc. So blue carbon is related to oceans, the phytoplanktons and the coastal vegetation. Like the coastal ecosystems like mangroves. So it is a straightaway question, carbon captured by oceans and coastal ecosystems. This is the, I think, the easiest question from environment ecology. In the nature, which of the following are most likely to be found surviving? Now in the geography discussion, when we discuss the tundra type of climate, we say that the lichens are you can say they can develop in any weather. They can develop on even without soil. In fact, if you go for this topic of ecological succession, there also we discuss like lichens and the mosses. These are the you can say primary vegetation there. So this question could also be considered as the easier question. 2 and 3. These two, they will be there. So any option which has 2 and 3, so C is correct. You even do not require to think about the fern and the mushrooms. This is also the relatively easier question. As far as this question is concerned, in the optional geography, when we discuss about the ocean deposits, we discuss about these diatoms. Okay. Now, diatoms are basically, these are algae, okay, and cyanobacteria is also known as blue-green algae, though it is more of a bacteria, but it is blue, it is also known as blue-green algae. Now, these two are the primary producers, okay, they can be considered as the phytoplanktons. While the foraminifera and the copepods, these belong to the animal kingdom. In fact, the foraminifera is like a amoeba. Okay. Now, this question is more of a question where you can say it is more like those of you who have the background of biology will be finding it on the easier side. But for the rest, it may be a relatively difficult question. But this cyanobacteria, this is must, okay? This may give you a hint. Even diatoms, most people might be knowing, but this you should know. So, these two options are automatically eliminated. And then it comes to 50-50. Most of you might have, if you have read about the oceanography, the word diatom must have come, and it is a primary producer. So, it all depends on how much you have studied. Okay, so it is, you can say, for some it will be easy question, for some it will be a difficult question. As far as this question is concerned, now I feel this is a relatively difficult question, because pangolin they have asked probably because there have been some news from China, the people eat pangolin, and from there the COVID virus and all these things have come. Maybe that may be the reason why they have asked about this. As far as hedgehog, pangolin and marmot is concerned, I feel you should look at them first. Okay, this is pangolin. This is hedgehog. Okay, and this hedgehog has, it is like a squirrel, a relatively bigger squirrel, and it has these spines, and in these are hollow spines, and in between them you have keratin. Okay, similarly these are scales, and these are made up of keratin. These are hard. Okay, so what happens is, if a predator comes, they somehow roll, and you can say they take a shape like a sphere, somewhat spherical shape, and they save themselves. As far as this marmot is concerned, it is this, and it doesn't have this kind of scales, but they also save themselves by digging some burrow and like that. But as far as this question is concerned, the correct answer will be hedgehog and pangolin. This question will be a difficult question for anybody. Okay, we generally do not study about these animals in this much detail. With reference to the New York Declaration of Forest, now because of HE targets, because of climate change, all this this was in news, not recently, but quite often, along with HE targets, you somehow get to read about this New York Declaration of Forest. Okay, so it was first endorsed in the United Nations Climate Summit in 2014. So, along with the Sustainable, you can say, Development Goals in 2015, along with the Paris Climate Change Treaty, this New York Declaration of Forest, there were some discussion around this. So, this is true. It was first endorsed at the UN Climate Summit in 2014. It endorses a global timeline to end the loss of forest. Yes, this is also correct. It is a legally binding international declaration. No, if it would have been a legally binding international declaration, then almost all of us would have read it about this in too much detail. So, it is not true. It is endorsed by governments, big companies and indigenous communities. Yes, it is also true. So, as far as 1 and 2 is concerned, this is correct. Now, the only option where 1 and 2 both are there is this, okay? And most of the such declarations, such treaties, they are endorsed by governments, big companies, corporates, etc. So, this could have been a relatively intelligent guess if you would have gone with this option 4, okay? So, 1, 2 and 4. So, the correct option will be this A1, okay? Relatively unknown type of declaration, and treaty has been asked. The more general ones, Kigali, Paris, etc., they have been ignored. So that does not mean that you should forget everything, whatever you have studied, because it really hurts. If you have studied about a particular topic, you have made extensive notes, and then they don't ask, it hurts. Nevertheless, I will say that will be, you can say that will be relevant in mains. You could get a question from that. HE target was quite expected. Even I was saying since this 2020 is a time where we are assessing how much we have achieved in the last decade as far as biodiversity conservation is concerned. So maybe they may give you about the HE targets, but they have not given. Okay. So magnetite particles suspected to cause neurodegenerative problems are generated. Now this is straight away from the news items. In our brain, there are some nanoparticles which have some magnetic properties. These are magnetite particles. Now these are nanoparticles, so they somehow, you can say they are airborne, and they help, you can say they are a cause for diseases like dementia, diseases like Alzheimer's, the neuro degenerative problems which have some connection with the neurons. And if you go for some newspaper reading, I have here. Let me check. Yes, how we discovered a possible link between car exhausts and Alzheimer's. So this is some news item. Now it is clearly mentioning, maybe the question might have been framed from this particular website only. Vehicles are a major source of these magnetite nanospheres. They are created by fuel combustion, especially diesel, iron wear from the engine block, and frictional heating from brake pads. In addition to some occupational settings, high concentration of magnetite pollution nanoparticles may be produced indoors by open fires or poorly sealed stoves used for cooking or heating. So they have, most probably they have sourced the question from here. So all these 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 could be considered as the source for the magnetite particles. Nevertheless, going for post facto analysis of a question is much easier, but solving the same question in the examination hall under pressure, okay, with relatively limited amount of knowledge, I will say this question is again on the difficult side. Okay, even if you know about this, what are the exact sources from where these particles could be, could come? I feel this will be a difficult question. Okay, now which one of the following is a filter feeder? Okay, again, this is a relatively difficult question. As I have already told you, the questions from environment ecology, they are less from the core topics which we study, and more from the biology and about the animals, etc., some specific characteristics of the animals. Like here they have asked about a filter feeder. Now oysters have this ability that they intake a lot of volume of water, and then they extract the nutrients, extract the food particles for themselves, and release the rest of the water. Through that, they are known as filter feeder, and they are also helping in the filtration of the water. Okay, so oysters are natural filter feeders. This means they feed by pumping water through their gills, trapping particles of food as well as nutrients, suspended sediments, and chemical contaminants. In doing so, oysters help keep the water clean and clear for underwater grasses and other aquatic life. If you are aware of this, okay, fine. Else this will be a difficult question. As far as this question is concerned, this is straight away from the discussion which we had in our classes, and in almost all the courses, whether it is pen drive course where we discuss the geography, environment ecology, disaster management, everything, even in the normal offline classes. This phosphorus cycle is discussed, and there the most important point which we discuss is that it is the biogeochemical cycle where weathering is most important. In fact, in this phosphorus cycle, the role of atmosphere is almost nil. Atmosphere has almost no role. It is a solid phosphate rocks are there. They are weathered. It goes into marine life or aquatic life, and thereby the organisms they intake, and then again there is a cycle. I'm not going to explain you all the cycles, but this is the most important point which is discussed in the class as well. Okay, which of the following are detrivorous? Detrivorous are those species which feed on, you can say, the dead ones, like the earthworms, even the millipedes, wood lice. These three are known as detrivores. Even fungi are detrivorous. Now, as far as how you could have gone with this question, earthworm, this everyone knows it is a detrivore. Seahorse is not a detrivore. Most of you might be knowing about this. So, you can check for the option which has one but which does not have either two or four. Jellyfish is also not a detrivore. So, in this, the correct option will be this 1, 3 and 5. I have the picture also. Okay. A detrivore is an organism that eats dead or decaying plants or animal as food. Detrivores include microorganisms such as bacteria and larger organisms such as fungi, insects, worms and some crustaceans. Now, a detrivore eats dead plants and animals. Now, this is, what is this? This is millipedes. Okay. Now, what is wood lice? It is a crustacean. This is a crustacean. Okay. As far as this question is concerned, the earthworm, millipedes and crustacean, I feel it is again a difficult question. Okay. Now, you should understand the strategy to qualify the prelims is not to go about and attempting every question. You need to pick and choose. Okay. Obviously, you'll have to bat very aggressively in prelims. That is true. But nevertheless, don't try to hit the ball which is outside the off stump, because the chances will be that you'll be caught behind. Okay. You just need to select the 80 to 85 good questions which you have some idea, and rest 10 to 15 questions, just don't look at them. Okay. And out of 80 to 85, let's say you have attempted, even if 20 questions go wrong, yes, if you have attempted 80 questions, even 20 questions if they are wrong, then also you have a good chance to somehow write the mains paper. Okay, that is why I generally say, okay, be a little bit bold during the prelims exam, and that I am saying on the basis of my experience. The common carbon metric, now this is again a relatively easier question, because many times this has been in the news, carbon footprint of building operations around the world. So, it is supported by UNEP, common carbon metric. This question was relatively from the, you can say, if you have read nicely the current affairs segment of environment ecology, you could have gone with the correct option. Which of the following have a species that can establish symbiotic relationship with other organisms? Fungi is there, fungi and plus algae, these are lichens. So, this will be there. But by just knowing this, you will not be able to solve the question. As far as this cnidarians are concerned, if instead of this they could have given corals, because corals are a type of cnidarians, okay, if they would have given this corals, then 1 and 2 will be there, okay, and then you will be going with the only this option. Protozoa is also, you can say, with in the intestines of the animals. It is in symbiotic relationship with the termites. It also has some symbiotic relationship with bacteria and algae. So again, I'll say this environment and ecology paper this year is moving more towards biology. In fact, ecology is somewhat a stream which shares a lot of you can say topics with biology also. So this year they have gone more towards bio. That is, the trend is visible. Okay, so all three, if instead of this they could have given corals, because there are many types of cnidarians, corals are one of it. Okay, so this and this. If you want to read, you can read. Cnidarian, also called as coelenterate, any member of the phylum Cnidaria, a group made up of more than 9,000 living species. From here, mostly marine animals, the cnidarians include the corals, hydras, jellyfish, Portuguese men of war, sea anemones, sea pens, sea whips, and sea fans. So there are many types of cnidarians. Corals are one of it. Consider the following statements. Now again, these questions are straight away from the current affairs. The United Nations Capital Development Fund and the Arbor Day Foundation have recently recognized. This is from the news. Okay. If I could get this. Yes. Look, this is straight away from the Hyderabad recognized as a tree city of the world. So this is from the news, okay, from Indian Express. And the reason for this recognition has also been given. But the important point is that this statement is wrong. The first statement is wrong. Instead of United Nations Capital Development Fund, it is FAO, Food and Agricultural Organization. So because of the, you can say, more and more plantation of trees in the Hyderabad, in the urban centers, it has been selected. So from India, Hyderabad has been selected. More than 50 other cities have also been selected. So Hyderabad was selected for the recognition for a year following its commitment to grow and maintain the urban forest. So both this statement one is not correct, because it was from Food and Agricultural Organization. This is from current affairs, and if you have read, you could have solved. In the context of India's preparation for climate smart agriculture, consider the following statements. Now this question could have been discussed by the geography faculty as well. But since the word climate is there, so I am discussing it here. Climate smart agriculture means the climate resilient agriculture. That means the agricultural practices which are in tune with the climate change challenges. So climate smart agriculture, consider the following. This question, climate smart village, this topic was in news. Yes, climate smart village approach was in news. But to know all these things, this is highly factual question, and I feel this will be again a relatively difficult question. Okay, unless you have, you can say, read it very seriously and you have it in your notes, you have mugged up these facts, you'll not be able to solve them. Okay, so because there is hardly where any option where you can go for some elimination also. The climate smart village approach in India is a part of project led by the Climate Change Agriculture and Food Security, an international research program. Yes, this project of CCAFS is carried out under consultative group on international agriculture research headquartered in France. Again, a fact. The International Crops Research Institute for Semi-Arid Tropics in India is one of the CGIAR's research center. I feel this question was given just to make the question paper difficult, and most of you might have left it as well. Okay. So, is there any other question? So, which of these statements given above are correct? I feel this will be the correct answer. All these are correct. Then there is again a question from urbanization. This again shares boundary with geography and environment ecology. In fact, environment and ecology, whatever we study, is just an application part of the geography. Okay, application and the more dynamic part. Right to the city, it was you can say, because of the UN Habitat and the Habitat 3 initiative, this right to the city term, it gained popularity, and that is why they may have asked this question. So, right to the city is an agreed human right. Yes, UN Habitat monitors the commitments made by each country in this regard. Right to the city gives every occupant of the city the right to reclaim the public spaces. Basically, it is an approach where some kind of inclusive model of urbanization is to be accepted, and that is to be promoted, whereby all these sections are included in the development initiatives, included in the urbanization activities. As far as the third point, right to the city means that the state cannot deny any public service or facility to the unauthorized colonies in the city. This will be relatively more extreme kind of view. So, this may not be the correct statement, but as far as these two are concerned, they'll be there. So, 1 and 2 will be the correct option as far as what we think. Okay. So, with this, we have discussed the environment and ecology segment of the UPSC prelims paper 2021. The final word from my side is, whatever has happened, that has happened. You people should focus on the next paper, that is the UPSC mains. Even if you are, let's say, around 47, 48, you never know which option which you have selected is considered the correct option by the UPSC. So, you could get a chance. Even the cutoff could be somewhat on the lower side, because we never know how others have performed. In this kind of competitive paper, guessing or estimating the cutoff is the most difficult part. Okay, one question here and there, you may be in the academy, or you could be preparing again. Okay, so with this note and with all sorts of luck to you all, I'll end this session here. Thank you.